Where mercy reigns and never dies. And there's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all the love I've ever comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I need all of you, I need all of you. Where your love ended and my sin white, I owe to you, I owe to you, Jesus.
Would you stand and worship with us?
There's a place where sin and shame are powerless.
Crimson stain, he washed it white. This is a holy moment, a moment where we remember and give praise to God for what he's done. Can we just do that for a moment? Thank you, Jesus. Here is where our hope is found. Amen. Welcome into this space. Welcome to our service tonight. We're so glad that you're here tonight. Good Friday is a time to reflect and to meditate on God's great love for us. Ephesians 3:18 says that, I pray that you would have the power to grasp how wide, how long, how high, how deep is God's love. That's what we want to do tonight. We don't want to just know about the sequence of events that happened this week for Jesus. We don't want to just know about God's love, but we want to know that love. We want to spend some time grasping the depth of that love, to really sit with the sorrow, the pain and the passion that Jesus was experiencing, and to remember that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Praise God. I want to give you a note tonight. Parents, if you're in the room, I want you to know that the quiet room and the nursery are available for you if you want to take your children in there at any point. And we're excited to continue to worshiping and reflecting tonight. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your incredible, enormous love for us, the extravagant love that you sent your only son to die for us. God, I pray that you would ready our minds and our hearts to reflect, to look at our lives and think about what you did on the cross for us, God, the price that you paid for us specifically, God. I pray that you would just open up our hearts to inwardly reflect on that, God, and just fill us with hearts of gratitude tonight as we focus in on this, Lord. We thank you for what you're going to do in this place in our hearts tonight. In your name we pray, amen. Let's worship.
My Savior bled for me, my Jesus set me free. And look at the wounds that give me life, grace flowing from his side, no greater sacrifice. What he's done, what he's done, all the glory is heaven. I praise God for what he's done. Sing for the freedom he has won. Even death is dead in time. His life has overcome. Oh, speak, say the name.
Yeah.
See, on a hill of Calvary, my Savior bled for me. My Jesus set me free.
Thank you, Lord.
Look at the wounds that give me life. Grace flowing from His side. No greater sacrifice.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you,
Father.
I know with you all things.
Good evening. I'm so glad you're in the room tonight. And for those watching online, it is just a privilege to unite with you tonight. You are a precious soul, you're a precious person, and you have precious faith. When you look at Jesus and you say, "My Jesus," you're able to do that because you have first said, "My sin." And on Good Friday, it's the day where Jesus took my sin. He dealt with the curse and he dealt with the consequences so that I could experience the weight of his glory. Before we get into God's word tonight, I just want to welcome you to a few days of wonderful moments on holy ground touched by the presence of God. Easter weekend here is special to us because our whole faith is built on the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and it's built on the ransom price that he paid for you and for me, and so this is really the core of it. This is the foundation of it all. We stand on it strong, we jump on it, we're going to get loud and sing and dance on Easter Sunday, but you're here at a really special time, and I pray that you hear a special word from the Lord. Before we look into the word, I want to say thank you to the worship team and the media team for putting together these elements, bringing us to the cross with these songs. It is so poignant, it's so clear, and it's very touching and moving for us. I also want to let you know about something that's happening kind of in an ongoing way, and it's going to be happening during our worship experiences on Sunday this week. Our whole city stood in the middle of brokenness and tragedy. We stood in destruction. We stood in the fragileness and in the devastation of what we experience in this broken world when 10 million pounds of concrete and steel fell into the harbor, and several unexpected people lost their earthly lives. Through some connections through our church body and friendships, I spent time this week with two widows. The wife of Minor Suaso and also the wife of Miguel Luna, two of the construction workers that were standing on the bridge when this terrible catastrophe happened. We were able to pray with them and encourage them and come around them and support them. Minor's wife Berenice and their entire family are going to be with us on Easter Sunday morning here in the service, and we're also going to be able to not only pray for them, but support them through Kingdom Builders. And so if you're someone who is unfamiliar with how we minister and how we build God's kingdom through Trinity, we do it through our faith, through our worship, through our testimony, but we also do it through our resources. We're a tithing church. We give 10% of our income to God, and then we give above and beyond that in sacrificial love. You can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. And so what we do here at Trinity is we call it Kingdom Builders, and through our Kingdom Builders giving, which you'll see a little Kingdom Builders line on the drop-down menu on our online giving page, and then also in the envelopes in the back of the room, there's an opportunity to write in Kingdom Builders, an amount, and put it in the offering. And so this weekend, as we give towards Kingdom Builders, we're going to be rallying around these families who have experienced loss, affected families of the deceased during this catastrophe. And we're going to be able to do things like help them with rent and help them with immediate needs. So I thank you for your giving and helping us play a big part in making a tangible difference during this difficult time. Tonight, we aren't passing the offering buckets or having an offering moment, but as you leave, those buckets and then also boxes on the back wall are available to you to make a gift, a contribution, or also on Easter Sunday in both experiences. You're welcome to do that, and we'll make sure that that money through Kingdom Builders goes to help these families. Well, tonight I want to share God's word with you and bring hopefully some insight and some understanding to something that the original readers, the original audience of the Gospels would have understood when they read it. Hopefully tonight we will all have that understanding. This message is called Love Crushed at the Olive Press. Love Crushed at the Olive Press. The consequences of the curse of sin were twofold, really: exile, separation, and death. What we read when we read the account of Jesus's final 24 hours on earth, we read that every single person, everyone Jesus knew, either left him or led him to exile and death. They conspired, schemed, betrayed, abandoned, abused, tortured, denied, shamed, and condemned him. And we also see that we are in the story. We're in the story twice. We led him, and we left him. There's a personal realization that each of us needs to have that it wasn't only my fearful soul that left Jesus because I didn't want to pay the price, but also my sin led him to death. The realization that his redemption applies to me because my trespasses, my offenses, my atrocities were applied to him. When we realize that we wanted to hurt and humiliate and hang him every time we've rebelled against God. When we realize that we laughed on his way to the cross. We forced the sharp, jagged thorns down, digging into his head. That we're in the story. We drove the nails through his flesh, and we kept his back moving up and down and up and down on that rough, rugged cross. Beyond the human judgment, beyond the Roman torture, beyond the corrupt trial, Jesus took on the weight of the curse of sin so that we could experience that weight of glory. He knew that the rejection would be physical and spiritual, and the suffering would be physical and spiritual, because he understood something about Gethsemane that I'd like to look at with you tonight. After the Last Supper, the Passover meal with his disciples, Jesus goes to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. This is what it says in Matthew 26. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." So he took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and he prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and he found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping a second time because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and he went away once more, a third time, and he prayed this. We're switching to Luke 23 now. "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him, and being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. Even before the first blow was landed, even before Judas kissed him and betrayed him, the anguish and the sorrow of the cup of God's wrath began to be poured out upon him. His soul, the spiritual suffering, began to be laid. The Garden of Gethsemane is on the Mount of Olives. There are olive trees throughout it, olive trees that look like this behind me. This is from the Garden of Gethsemane today. And here's another tree from the Garden of Gethsemane that you could see. Sometimes these olive trees are wider and they kind of have these shoots and trunks kind of shooting out in many, many branches. Sometimes they're thinner like this one. Oftentimes they don't grow like an oak tree here where they're straight up and they branch out, but they can kind of grow a little bit twisted and they provide opportunity for you to sit on them nicely or lay on them or pray at them. And this is where Jesus was that evening. Gethsemane is on the Mount of Olives, but the word Gethsemane, you may not know this tonight, is Gat Shemanim, and it means olive press. Gat is a place for pressing, and Shemanim means olive oil. So literally, Gethsemane means the olive press. When I visited Israel, I spent a day in Nazareth. And one of the places that I visited with a team from Trinity was called the Nazareth Village. In the Nazareth Village, it's kind of like stepping back in time. They have many, many things that are just like they would have been during Jesus's day. There's a shepherd there that walks you through his shepherding practices. There's someone weaving there just like people would have done making clothing in Jesus' day. There is a wine press. In this wine press, fascinating. They actually excavated through archaeology a cascading hillside that was a vineyard. They found the stones that would have been set up just like a vineyard would have been. And back in Christ's day, Nazareth was only 300 to 400 people large. That was the population. Now it's about 100,000 people. But back then, 300 to 400 people. And so the wine press event was a community event. So the likelihood, the chances that at the bottom of this vineyard where they excavated a wine press, a stone basin that had been hewed out where people would step in them and mash down the grapes, the chances that Jesus's teenage feet were in that wine press and stomping those grapes is highly likely. Just an amazing place. Not only did they have those things, but they had a replica synagogue. And, you know, the synagogue of Jesus's day wasn't so many seats facing a platform or facing one communicator or some people communicating, but it was almost in the round. It was a rectangle where people are seated on all sides and someone would be in the middle. Oftentimes, the rabbi that was teaching would be having discussion with the room. It was like a small group, and it was just an amazing experience. But my favorite thing at the Nazareth Village was the olive press. They showed us this olive press that I knew nothing about. This is what it looks like. There is a beam, it's kind of a seesaw, and that beam is just a long piece of wood, and underneath you see here, there are these stone platforms, and what they would do is they would gather the olives, and they would put them in mesh sacks, almost like a burlap sack, but a little more sturdy, and they would put the olives inside of it, and they would press them to get out the olive oil. Now, they didn't just press it, get the oil out, and move on. It was a process. You see, the oil would run out in a certain way from these stone platforms, and they would fill up collection bowls in the vat below, and there was different types of oil, just like there is today. There were different types of oil with different purposes and usages that would come out of the olives. And I want to share those with you tonight because when the early readers of the gospel read about Jesus' experience in the Garden of Gethsemane, they would have immediately understood some things about an olive press that we can understand this evening. You see, Jesus went three times, leaving Peter, James, and John to go pray and to talk to God about this cup. We're going to come around to this cup in a minute. And three times the olives are pressed at the olive press. The first press is simple. This beam is simply laid down on the baskets. There's no extra weight applied. There's no extra pressure applied. It's just simply laid there on the baskets. In any oil, you know, some of these olives are so ripe. They're just bursting with oil. Any oil that comes out with almost no pressure at all being applied to it, this is what we today call extra virgin olive oil. It's the purest, the best, the cleanest oil that comes out of the olive. This first press produced oil that was used exclusively in the temple. In Israel, that first olive, it was like the tithe, right? The first that comes out, it's going to God. Well, they would take this extra virgin olive oil to the temple and they would use it to light the lampstands in the holy place. They would use it also to anoint people. And then thirdly, they would use it in sacrifice. The sacrifice that the oil was used in is called the grain offering. The grain offering is the daily offering that the worshiper would bring. It wasn't like, you know, the special offering on the Day of Atonement. It wasn't one of these other sacrifices. It was that daily purpose of being a worshiper, that daily expression of faith in God. And they would bring these grain offerings, and they would mix the oil in and roast it before the Lord. The understanding we have here is that through this first pressing, Jesus is bringing an anointing to his people, an anointing to become a worshiper of God, to be restored into God's image, to restore you to what you were created to do, which is to be in connection with God and glorify him. Anointing oil was going to be poured out of the anointed one, the Messiah. And that oil was going to be applied to you and me so we could live in daily worship. Isaiah 53:10 says, "Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand." Because of Jesus, I can come confidently and I can come daily, sprinkled with his oil, anointed to worship. The second press at the olive press was this. They would add heavy stone slabs to the press that would rest on the olives and push them down and crush these olives further and produce more oil. This oil was a little bit thicker. It was forcing the olives open a little bit more so that the thicker oil could come out. And this oil was used for medicine. It was used to bring about healing. Medicine to cure our sin sickness. Jesus' second pressing does that for our souls. This oil, it was also used for cooking. It's the oil that, you know, when you go to a nice Italian restaurant or you go down to Little Italy and they bring out the fresh bread, they bring out this oil, you put a little herbs and seasoning in it, and it's just delicious. Forget about it. This is that oil. And, you know, what we see right here is a connection not only to food, but that nourishes us, but also this connection to healing medicine. The Good Samaritan, if you remember that story, he finds the beaten man on the side of the road, and it says he treats his wounds with wine and oil. It's medicinal. And we read in Luke 5:31, Christ's purpose was to treat our sickness. Jesus answered them, "It's not the healthy who need the doctor, but the sick." Isaiah 53:4-5 reminds us, "Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed." The third press at the olive press was where they would add even more heavy stone slabs to this beam. But not just that. They would also add the weight of the presser. They would put on all the weight they had on this beam, crush these olives in these baskets with everything they had to apply to it. And then the person pressing it, and the best olive pressers were big guys. Were guys that had some weight that could really put their back into it, and they wouldn't just push on the beam, they would jump on this beam. They would body slam this beam. They would put everything on it to push out every last drop. Nothing was wasted. Nothing was left behind. This was thick, pulpy oil in the third press. And it was used for two purposes, for soap and for light. This third press produced oil for cleansing. Just like light cleanses out darkness and soap purifies and cleanses out the things that have defiled. You remember what we just read in Luke 22. In his anguish, in his prayer, as he's praying earnestly, as Jesus is peering over the edge of the cup of God's wrath, as he's peering over the edge into the suffering he's about to endure, the weight is falling on his human nature. You know, even in his distress, Jesus was not disobedient. But he kept stepping forward saying, "God, your will be done." But as he stood there, it said that he experienced hematidrosis, which is when your capillaries burst under intense stress and blood can come out of your forehead, and you can sweat drops of blood. This is what Jesus is experiencing, just like that thick oil was pushed out of those olives. In 1 John 1:7-9, it says, "If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. If we confess, if we meet him at the cross, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." And that light, the light that would light these lamps, this olive oil would produce, lamp lighting oil where everybody would have their individual little lamps. They would use this thicker and cheaper oil. And in the soap, the thickness of the oil, they would put it into soap to bring about cleansing. But this is what it says in Luke 22. We're reminded that Jesus said to the chief priests, temple officers, and elders who had come for him, "Have you come out with swords and clubs as you would an outlaw? Every day I was with you in the temple courts, and you did not lay a hand on me, but this hour belongs to you in the power of darkness." I just can't help but think that Jesus was thinking, go ahead and press me. This darkness is not going to last for long. This hour of darkness that will be poured out on me, that will crush me, is going to take this light of the world. And after the press, those who believe in me will also have my light in their temples through the Holy Spirit. They will be shining my light of this endless kingdom into the darkness. The darkness has not overcome it. And let's be reminded on Good Friday that the darkness has not understood it. Even in his last moments on the cross, the mystery of the gospel, this exchange of our pure Savior, Jesus Christ, for what had become a worthless creation, plays out that we could become his righteousness. He illustrates it in the last moment of his life. The darkness has not understood it. Right before Jesus commits his spirit to God and brings his last breath, he takes this moment and he looks at the thief and he gives hope to a humiliated criminal. The darkness has not understood the mystery of God. So what was Jesus experiencing in the garden? It wasn't just the oncoming human torment, but the spiritual weight of the curse of sin that was about to be satisfied in his person, in his body, and in his blood. It was the cup of God's wrath. You know, we sang it earlier tonight. He is the same God. All throughout the Old Testament, God talks to his people about the cup of his wrath. The cup of my wrath is about to be poured out. The cup of my wrath is coming, he says. He says it over and over and over. In fact, sometimes we see it spill some drops. We see in Noah's time, the earth is flooded, not completely, not totally poured out, but partially poured out. And then we see it with Israel as they are exiled, as they experience the consequences of their own sin, not completely, as God is bringing them in this restoration process back to their land, but we see it drip out and spilled out a little bit, splashing on creation, but it's pointing us to the one who will bear it all. God, through prophecy, is saying, the cup of my wrath will be poured out. And finally, it is on Jesus. Habakkuk 2:16 says, "You will be filled with disgrace instead of honor. The cup of wrath in the Lord's right hand will come around to you, and utter disgrace will be on your own glory." In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus was being pressed under the weight of what he alone was uniquely able to do. Only Jesus could drink the cup of God's wrath and satisfy the curse of sin. And at the cross, he drank the cup down to the bottom. He began to get a taste of it in the garden. And in his humanity, he started to stagger. But nevertheless, he was faithful. No one had to drink this cup that Jesus was about to drink. Not any of the martyrs since have drunk this cup like Jesus drank it. Not even Polycarp or William Tyndale, people that were bold martyrs, like William Tyndale, burned at the stake, and as the fire began to burn, he said, "This light will increase the light of the gospel that will be spread around the whole world." Not even the heroes of our faith took on what Jesus was uniquely and only able to take on for us. You know, sometimes we read the Passion Week text, and we hear about God's wrath, and we see what Jesus is praying in the garden, and we can be a little bit confused about the nature of God. That we can see a tension in God. Like, God is love. God is so loving. But we also see this wrath, and we maybe are confused thinking that God is wrathful. And these two things are pitted together against God, and there's this tension that needs to be resolved. But that's not the case. In fact, God's wrath exists because of God's love. It's actually a branch of God's love. God's wrath arises for the purpose of protecting that which he loves. It is not a shaken can of irritability ready to explode on innocent and ignorant people. No, God is slow to anger, confronting evil from a place of care out of holy love. Good thing that God is not wrathful, or you wouldn't be here tonight, and I wouldn't be standing here tonight. But God's wrath is an expression of his love, and to hold evil accountable is loving. To do it through Jesus is beautiful. To defend and protect people from injustice is loving. To do it through your only son, that's the gospel. At the cross, the wrath of God was poured out on the sin of the world, driven by the love of God. It wasn't for God was so fed up with the world that he gave his only son. It's because God so loved the world, he gave his only son. Through the cross, the love of God satisfies the wrath of God to redeem the people of God. It's not resolving a tension in different aspects of his character. The cross doesn't resolve his character, it reveals his character. It shows just how loving God is. He confronts the wickedness and evil with wrath, not in spite of his love, but because of it. Jesus wanted the Father's will more than he wanted to be spared from the terrors that awaited him. As he prayed in the garden, the love of God began to crush Jesus, just like the olives on the olive press, for you and for me, that you could be anointed, that you could be healed, and that you could be purified and cleansed. You may be in the room tonight and you're not sure if that ministry of Christ, that redemption has been applied to your soul. And in a few moments, we're going to come to this communion table and we're going to participate in an act of faith. But you might not be ready for that act of faith tonight if you haven't placed your faith and your obedience, your surrender in Jesus. Revelation 14:10 says it this way: whoever rejects Christ will also drink the wine of God's wrath, poured at full strength into the cup of his anger, and he will be tormented with fire. If you're in the house tonight, if you're watching online, and you want to receive God's goodness on Good Friday, you need to understand he can be your savior when you recognize he took on your sin. Would you stand with me? I just want to invite you to bow your head before the Lord tonight, and I want to give you an opportunity to receive salvation. Every day is the best day for salvation, but this weekend's special to us. What a time to open your heart to the love of God on the day that we mark when he exampled his love so clearly. If that's you, I'm just going to invite you to pray this prayer with me. Dear Jesus, I thank you for loving me. I thank you for going the extra mile so that I could take my first step. Today, God, give me awareness. Take off my blinders. Let me see clearly who I am. Let me see clearly what I'm created for. And God, let me take responsibility right now for my sin. Lord, I haven't been victimized into sin. I haven't been forced into sin, but God, I have chosen rebellion in my own heart. And Lord, I'm sorry. I lay it at your feet tonight. I don't want to carry it anymore. I don't want to walk in it anymore. I don't want to keep picking it up and laying it down. Lord, I lay it before you tonight. Would you give me your righteousness and take it? Jesus, cleanse me with your blood. Let me be born again. Give me new life. Lord, that I could worship you anointed to be a worshiper, that my soul could be healed from sin sickness, that I would be cleansed and purified. Jesus, I thank you. And in your name we pray these things. Amen. 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 That's a wonderful prayer. And if you just prayed that prayer tonight, we're in a serious moment right now. We're in a focused moment right now, but we just want to take an opportunity and put our hands together for you, because heaven is applauding right now and heaven is going crazy. Praise God. Praise God. In this moment, I want to invite you to keep standing. Observe this video about the crucifixion. And as you take in this reminder of Christ's path to the cross and what he did for us on the cross, I want to invite our elders and pastors that are serving communion tonight to go ahead and step to the tables. Watch this video. We're going to sing a song right after this video. And when the music begins and we begin to sing, I'm going to invite you to step out of your seat. And if you're a believer in Jesus Christ and you've given him your sin and received his righteousness, I'm going to invite you to come and take a piece of bread and pick up one olive wood communion cup. This is going to be yours tonight to keep. But just note this, they look empty because the inside is silver and the liquid is clear. They are not empty. Please do not knock them over. Pick them up carefully and hold the elements during this song. When the song is done, we are going to take communion together. because he stood in our place, because he received what we deserved, we can say it's Good Friday. In the moment, who did it seem good for? The disciples lost their teacher. Even the chief priests, the elders, the teachers of the law, they falsely convicted, and the Romans wrongly crucified Jesus. Who did it seem good for? Well, it seemed good for Barabbas, and it seemed good for the thief. Today, we stand here and we can say, I'm like that thief on the right. In 1 Corinthians 11, Paul writes us and he says, what I've received, I also pass on to you. On the night Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and broke it. He said, this is my body, which is given for you. Take it in remembrance of me. Jerry Chambliss is going to pray over the bread now. Sam Gloriosois. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight. And Lord, we thank you for your love, for an extravagant love, for a beautiful love, for love that led you to give your one and only son to die for us, to take our punishment. A love so great, Lord Jesus, that you allow those thorns to be pressed into your head, for your beard to be ripped out, for your body to be beaten and beaten, for those nails to pierce your flesh. For a love so great, Lord Jesus, that you allowed yourself to be beaten, that you were unrecognizable. Lord, we thank you that you became unrecognizable so that through our faith we could become recognizable as the children of God that you say that we are. We thank you. We thank you, Lord God. And so tonight, Lord Jesus, we take this bread, which is a symbol of your body that was broken for us. And we do this in remembrance of you. For Lord, we love you and we thank you. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Let's take the bread together. It's interesting that Jesus said at the Last Supper, when he instituted this communion practice for us, to take these elements in remembrance of him. And then later, the thief looks at Jesus and says, remember me. Remember me. Jesus had just taken on the curse of sin, the weight of this broken world, and the physical torment of the crucifixion for this man, for his soul. I like to think that Jesus looked back at him, and when he told him, today you'll be with me in paradise, it's like Jesus was saying, how could I forget you? When Jesus tells us to remember him in these elements, we get to say to Jesus, how could we forget? How could we forget what you've done for us? Likewise, Paul tells us, he then took the cup, filled it with wine. He passed it to his disciples and said, this is a cup, a new covenant in my blood. Whenever you gather, drink it in remembrance of me. Jerry Chambliss is going to pray.
Lord, we just thank you for your blood that was spilled on our behalf. God, that even now our sins are wiped clean because of what you accomplished for us that day. Lord, you suffered for us. Lord, your blood flowed so our sin could be wiped away and we could have fellowship with you. God, as we remember this new covenant we enjoy, written in your blood, Lord, we just remember, God. Lord, may this never become an exercise, God. Lord, we thank you for your grace, for your love that was demonstrated by the blood flowing. Amen.
Let's drink together. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Would you just take a minute and in your own words tell Jesus how much you love him? I love you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you for life. Lord, I love you so much. We're going to sing our praise to God, and After this song, there's going to be a video that connects to our Easter Sunday experience and how we're going to start that service. So I just want to invite you, sing this with us, observe this video begin, and then you'll be dismissed.
Nothing can for sin atone. Hope is found in you alone. Sin and death are overcome only by your precious blood. Nothing
a great light dawns in Galilee. Some say madmen, some say king. Wonder-working rebel priest, Jesus Christ the Nazarene. He knew well what it would take to free us all from sin and grave. A perfect man would have to die, and only he could pay that price. Friday's good 'cause Sunday is coming. Don't lose hope 'cause Sunday is coming. Devil, you're done, you better start running. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming. So he had the soldiers taken in. Has his friend betrayed him with a kiss? There before the mocking cry, like a lamb to the slaughter, didn't make a sound. Then he carried that cross to Calvary, and he shed his blood to set us free. As the nails went in and the sky went dark, the redemption of the world was on his heart. Cause Sunday's coming. Don't lose hope, cause Sunday's coming. Devil, you're dying, you better start running. Friday's good, cause Sunday's coming.
Then he breathed his last and bowed his head, the Son of God, and man was dead. With bloody hands, tears on their face, they laid him down inside that grave.
But that wasn't the end, that wasn't the end, that wasn't the end. Let me tell you what happened next. The women came before the dawn to find that stone already gone. When they looked inside, the angel said, why are you looking for the living among the dead? He's alive, hallelujah, he's alive. Give him praise, lift him high, hallelujah, he's alive. He's alive, he's alive, hallelujah, he's alive. Give him praise, lift him high, hallelujah, he's alive. Friday's good 'cause Sunday is coming. Jesus reigns upon the throne, all heaven sings to him alone. We watch and wait like a bride for a groom. Oh, church, arise, he's coming soon. He's coming soon.
grateful that the story doesn't end with Christ in the grave. He is risen. We want to see you this Sunday for your Easter services at 9 and 11 a.m. We'll see you there.